G&D Audio presents an unabridged recording of In Your Power, React Less, Regain Control, Raise Others by Sharon Melnick, PhD. Narrated by Diana Gardiner. To my clients who are in their power and raising everyone around them, you inspire me. Introduction. I can't sleep. I can't focus. It's like I'm under siege, Mary shared. He's squeezing me out and trying to lower my ownership stake. In her partnership group in a financial firm, Mary told me the senior partner started spreading rumors that she's a bully and the team is afraid of her. The young analysts joined in. She tried to speak to the offending partner, but he reacted with hostility, making the situation worse. She didn't feel she could get a fair response from the HR director or from their regional head because they were longtime buddies of his. She feared her only way out was to leave the firm. But that would be a big blow to her reputation, and why should she have to sacrifice all of the clientele she had worked for 20 years to establish? The senior partner also criticized her for her quality over quantity client service approach. He's making me feel like a failure. I've lost my confidence, and now I'm even questioning, maybe I should change, and maybe I really am a bully. Mary felt powerless. So did Steve. He was the head of a fast-growing technology startup, and his team members' repeated mistakes were like nails on a chalkboard to him. I can't get them to be more careful and to follow through on their work plans, he explained. He was getting impatient and would react, thinking, they're lazy, and also questioning, am I a bad leader? He brought his irritation home to his wife, which he knew was unfair. Mary and Steve were in situations that are similar to those many of us face. You feel that other people determine what happens to you. Their behavior gets to you and puts you into a mental swirl. You rehash the scenario, convincing yourself they're wrong or that there's something wrong with you. You get hijacked and react emotionally instead of responding with thoughtful intention. You see limited options to resolve the problem because whatever you've tried hasn't worked. You feel trapped. You want to be a role model for others or be the bigger person in the scenario, but you can see you are showing up as a diminished version of yourself. This is what it's like when you are out of your power. You want relief. You want the other person to do what you think they should do, believing that this is the only way to achieve a good or fair outcome. What you really want is to get back to your calm, confident self and refocus on living your life and making a difference for others in your company, community, or family. You want to be back in your power. If this describes how you are feeling anywhere in your life, this book is for you. I share the psychological insights and strategies you can use to immediately stop the mental swirl and quickly recover to be good in you. With fresh ways of overcoming your automatic reactions, you'll be free from the effects of other people on you. You'll achieve bigger business results, get promoted, improve the culture, and connect with difficult loved ones. You'll shift your experience from that of the thermometer to the thermostat. When you are the thermometer, your mental and emotional state goes up and down according to other people's behavior. You fixate on others' actions and see yourself at their mercy as if others act, all I can do is react. The climate outside of you determines the weather inside of you. You experience yourself as the casualty, not the creator of the outcome. As the thermostat, instead, you set the tone of your interactions with others, no matter what their behavior is, and you set the temperature of your internal state as well. You are able to bring people along in your vision. The thermostat harmonizes all the conditions in a room, the humidity, airflow, movement of people, to reach the decided upon temperature. As the thermostat, you can steward the whole situation to make it better. When you're in your power, you make an impact not by reacting to the behavior of people who are limited, but rather by raising yourself and others to be limitless. By the end of my first discussion with Mary, she regained this sense of control and confidence. She stopped taking the situation personally. Her emotional upset evaporated, and she slept well that night. She no longer looked to others to know her worth. Within days, the discussions she initiated with her partners led them to cease badmouthing her. She earned so much respect from them and for her client service approach that within 60 days, they voted her partner in charge of the group. Within 90 days, she brought in the biggest deal of her career, producing a windfall they all benefited from now that she'd begun enforcing their contractual agreement to do an equal draw on profits. Then she led an approach to diversify the talent in their group, and together they've grown the pie. Mary got back in her power. I have coached and trained over 40,000 senior leaders, entrepreneurs, and professionals in all levels of organizations around the world. And what I've found is that in the challenging situations where you find yourself off your game, the underlying issue is always that you're pulled out of your power. We are made to feel powerless in many ways. We feel unseen, unheard, or can't make an impact on people who are important to us in our professional and personal lives. We may be dismissed, overlooked, or uncredited by a manager, or sabotaged by a colleague. We can't convince executive peers to move past corporate scorecards toward true transformation in the culture. We might feel disrespected by a bully boss, a difficult family member, or be overloaded with more than our fair share of work. We can't get our team members to live up to our expectations or respect our leadership. We don't get our needs met by a partner or friend. We're made to second-guess ourselves. Business as usual can put us out of our power by piling on excessive demands and constant change. In the workplace and culture at large, we don't feel psychologically safe, and these places are rife with harms in the form of inequitable pay and advancement, microaggressions, and violence. On social media, we have reason to fear we'll be canceled or trolled. Political systems make us feel our values are not protected or are violated. Being out of your power is not a sign of some inherent weakness within you. Usually, it means you care about getting a good result, about fairness and respect, and about the greater good. Everyone can get out of their power regardless of how emotionally intelligent or highly accomplished they are. An acquaintance of mine is a former Army general. His son verbally attacks him regularly, and every day he has the sinking feeling he's a bad father. As we'll explore in the next chapter, we are even biologically hardwired to get kicked out of our power. When we get out of our power, we do what we can to help us regain control. We blame the offending person for what they've done or haven't done, and plan what we'll say to them if we have the chance. We seek sympathy in venting to others. We spin about whether to stay or go, and then get to the point we start to disengage. We try not to think about the situation by drinking, numbing ourselves with social media, or other unhealthy habits. Well-meaning advice from friends, family, or blog writers tells us to let it go, just leave, give it time, be persistent. This advice offers encouragement rather than true empowerment. It suggests we grit our way through the problem or continue to do things that aren't working. It doesn't address that something fundamental to you is being crossed. Your sense of self, your truth, your boundaries, your vision, your sense of fairness about the way the world should work, or all of these. Wrestling with these situations can interfere with our mental well-being and contribute to burnout over and above our culture of too much to do. We can even develop mental health symptoms, such as anxiety, which comes from thoughts about lacking a sense of control, or depression, which can come from anger that is turned against oneself when no recourse is available. Emotions and behavior from past traumas can be reactivated, and post-traumatic symptoms can develop when you experience the situation as inescapable. Not having an effective way to navigate these scenarios derails careers. I've seen it to be a major reason people leave an organization or relationship, or decide to stay but just go through the motions, which is not who you are. The temptation is to avoid collaborating with the other person, eroding connection and trust among coworkers, friends, and family members. Leaders can react with overwhelm or pursue their own agenda rather than serve the team. Being out of your power destroys dreams and kills joy. More than ever, we are determined to overturn these situations when we face them, personally or collectively. We are fed up with situations where someone else's actions make you feel bad about your value or constrain your success. With the ongoing stress of pandemic-related circumstances, economic uncertainty, and an overdue reckoning on social injustices, our resilience is worn down. We are factoring in our mental well-being and prioritizing environments where we can do meaningful work drama-free. We're ready to be the change we want to see in the world, making things better for all involved. We want to go beyond the temporary effects of a massage, a manicure, or a good workout. We seek a practical response repertoire we can use in the heat of the moment to further our goals and experience lasting well-being. Being in your power is the ultimate form of self-care. It is the root cause solution for the successful life you want. As a business psychologist and executive coach, I began to make the connection between being out of our power as adults and insights I learned from 10 years of research at Harvard Medical School in my early career. My initial focus was on studying what we bring with us from childhood into our parenting in the next generation. For people who had difficult experiences, I came up with methods to heal the wounds, become their own person, transcend their patterns, and act toward their children in a way they would have wanted for their own life. Without realizing it, in my research, I had been putting together the psychological processes of getting back in your power. Over 20 years of coaching clients, I heard about the issues they were struggling with in their workplace, and I started to see how the approaches I had developed for helping people overcome early trauma-related patterns in their parenting applied to a broad range of work and social environments in which people don't feel seen, heard, or can't have the impact they're here for. And I needed this myself. I was a person who reacted all day long to other people and got tossed about by matters large and small that didn't go my way. If a friend said something ambiguous to me, I'd spend the rest of my day rehashing it. I sought others' approval and tried to prevent their disapproval. Books told me to look within, but all I found was a cacophony of self-criticism. Life happened to me. When I used my voice, I didn't see it have an impact. As is true for so many, being out of my power had become my way of being in the world. I plunged myself into learning how I could coach people to apply these approaches in work challenges, starting with how I could use them to build ownership over myself as well. From coaching thousands to be confident, influential leaders, I've observed that the biggest unlock to business outcomes rarely comes from one or another specific tactic, but rather from knowing how to get in and stay in their power. It comes from their new way of understanding what the problem is, the energy they emit, and the command with which they bring others along into win-win solutions. The word power is loaded. We associate it with being predatory, selfish, or manipulative, and with people abusing their power. Being in your power is not about wielding your power over others or achieving your ends through force. This happens with people who are in power, but not in their power. They may behave in these ways because of insecurity, fearing that if they don't show they are powerful, they will be subject in the same ways to others' power. Research suggests that, as the saying goes, power can go to your head. Studies show that high-power individuals are more likely to direct their energies in pursuit of their own goals and that their empathy can be reduced. Being in your power has a different character. The word power comes from the Latin root posse, which means to be able. In your power is your ability to stay good in you, no matter what's going on around you. Being in your power is the ability to alchemize the challenging aspects of what goes on outside of you in order to get into a good place inside of you so that you can then take actions to achieve your aims and make the situation as you envision it should be outside of you. Being in your power actually encompasses two abilities: to be in your power and to use your power as a force for good. The for good piece is key. I want to redefine power so we embrace it as a force for good. When I refer to using your power, I mean the power to use yourself as an instrument to make a situation better. The power to get a better result, to resolve friction at root cause, to implement innovative ideas, or to create a culture in which you and others thrive. It's the potential of this positive use of power that led Ron Carucci, expert on executive success and author of Rising to Power, to say what he found in his 10-year study among those who assume leadership positions is that the biggest abuse of power is not using it. When you are in your power, you have a sense of control over your own mental and emotional state, thoughts, and actions. You respond rather than react. You decide who you are and what you will and won't accept. You own your choices. The course of your life isn't happening to you, it's happening from you, through you, and for you. You achieve your desired impact to make the situation better, not only for you, but for everyone involved. In your power, you stop taking things personally or holding on to them. Your well-being is preserved regardless of others' behavior, because other people are not the supply line to your emotional oxygen. You are. You don't have to worry about their judgments of you, because you decide who you are. That gives you freedom. In your power, you're Teflon to the negative effects of situations. You can see them as they unfold in real time, understand everyone's motivations and needs, and respond strategically. You model new standards and hold space for new conversations. You also know how to quickly step back into your power if you do get kicked out of it. What you say is heard. You get the outcome you want. The situation gets resolved at root cause. You are proud of how you handled it. It doesn't fester or continue to drain you. Your energy is freed up to devote to the people and activities you love and the contribution you are here to make. You are able to inspire and lift others, empowering them with your power. You leave the situation better than it was when you came into it. When you are in your power, you raise everyone around you. You'll see the effects everywhere in your life. Being in your power fuels resilience and mental well-being. It gives you a calm, clear mind so you can hold on to your important thoughts and have renewable energy. Allows you to resolve problems rather than deciding to leave. Being able to handle unyielding situations allows you, if it's the right fit, to stay and rise in the organization, transform a poisonous relationship into a fruitful collaboration, and bring a huge win to the team. Or grow your own company. Enables you to make a difference for others. You can grow power in other people once you've grown it in yourself. Being able to make a bigger impact makes my clients giddy and brings the delight back into work. Helps you cope with societal injustice and change it. Systemic inequities must be resolved by dismantling the structures that hold them in place. That is the only and ultimate fix. Until that is complete, being in your power can help you personally deal with injustices, helping you not be triggered and overcome their personal effects on you. Being in your power will set you up to sustain yourself and respond effectively and emphatically so you can be an agent of change. In the following chapters, I'm going to show you how much power you have right now within you that you can use immediately to start feeling good in you and achieve the change you desire. I take you on a tour of what I call power portals. They are like doorways that lead to new ways of understanding the situation you are struggling with and how you can transform it. There are 12 of them. The first 6 portals will show you how to get in your power and stay there when challenged. The next 6 portals show you how to use your power for the good of all, both in interpersonal scenarios and in positions of power, regardless of what role you are in. You'll learn from a wealth of stories of others who were challenged and out of their power and then turned their situations around to get buy-in for their ideas, get promoted, get the team performance they wanted, or resolve personal friction to strengthen a relationship. As you learn to access the power the portals open your eyes to, you will find that being in your power becomes a lifestyle. You'll walk in the world as an infinite creative force to make any situation serve your good intentions and steward outcomes where everyone wins. In your power, you are a change agent, simply by the way you show up. Around the time this book was starting to become a possibility, I had a call with a colleague of mine, Joe, who's a senior HR leader. A few days prior, she had left her role as the HR lead in a startup after 1 year, saying about the experience, "It was like quicksand, but I persevered." She was confused. "I was hired to bring in a new vision, and then the founders blocked the vision." She started to question herself. "Am I smart enough to do this? I became afraid of saying the wrong thing when these jackasses say the first thing that comes to mind. I felt like I was losing my mind." She confessed, "I know that whole idea of putting your oxygen mask on first before you can do it for others, but I lost that ability, even though this wasn't my first rodeo. I'm usually the one telling other people how to handle this." What does one do in this situation? I went to people I follow on Instagram searching for a quote or a meme that could help me. I saw a video by a guru telling me how I should look in the mirror and tell myself, "I believe in me." That helped for 30 seconds. Then she said to me, "I know I have that within me, but I'm unable to find it and tap into it now. I wish there was a place I could go and fill up how to be in my power, how I could find this within, rather than have to seek it elsewhere or through other people. Can you recommend a book I could read over and over again to regain it?" I shared with her my framework for understanding her situation to ensure it doesn't happen again. At the end of our conversation, she said, "This is the first time I've felt calm in months." Oh. And about that book recommendation she asked about. I got you, Joe. Here it is. Part 1. Be the thermostat, not the thermometer. Chapter 1. From out of your power to in your power. It is never too late to be who you might have been. George Eliot. Pen name of English author Mary Ann Evans. Early in my career, I had tickets to a rock concert in Washington, D.C., one of those blockbuster lineups with all your favorite musicians. As the stands were starting to fill, I noticed a cluster of people in the row ahead of mine, and to my surprise, I recognized one of them. It was Tipper Gore, wife of then-Vice President Al Gore. She was a strong advocate for policies to improve the lives of women and children, and I thought we might have synergy in our missions. Without a moment's hesitation, I marched over to her, reached out to shake her hand, and said, "Hi, I'm Dr. Sharon Melnick." I do psychology research at Harvard Medical School on how parents who grew up in difficult circumstances can have resilience and confidence to break intergenerational cycles. Tipper's interest was piqued, and we chatted about our work and about our daughters. Suddenly, she turned to her chief of staff and said, "Melissa, could you get Dr. Melnick's contact information? We want to invite her to the White House to share the policy implications of her research." On the flight home, I thought about how fortunate I am that from early in my life, starting at about age 5, I have known what work I wanted to do in the world. I wanted to help people turn their private suffering into powerful service and make the contribution they're here to make. This is what I was here for, what I had studied for so long and worked so hard for. Now, maybe I had made a connection that would make that dream a reality. I wrote a short description of the research and emailed it to Melissa. A few weeks later, as I was lacing up my sneakers to go for a run, my phone rings. It was Melissa. She filled me in about Tipper's initiatives helping millions of families around the country, and at a certain point, she popped the question. "Will you come down to the White House to share the policy implications of your research?" My heart raced with nervous excitement, imagining how I could make such an impact. "So what do you think I said?" "Well, of course," I said, "no." I didn't exactly say no. I said, "I'm not sure I know enough yet from the research. Let me get back to you when we know more." "It's okay. Go ahead and gasp." Why? I pictured myself sitting around that table at the White House, presenting our findings to Tipper and a group of important policymakers. Even though I had won an award for my work, I was convinced that those people would think I wasn't smart enough. So I prioritized what I thought they might think about me over the once-in-a-lifetime contribution I could have made to the lives of millions of families. I gave them all the power to determine what impact I could or couldn't make. Even if I was in my power during other parts of my day, in that moment, I was pulled out of my power. Whether it's someone else's behavior or something that gets activated in ourselves, we shift into a state in which our thoughts, emotions, and actions align to disempower us. If you can think of being in your power as a state you can get out of, then by definition, it's a state you can come back into. When you name it, you contain it. You can know when you're in and when you're out. Returning to this state is inherently within your control, even though the catalyzing event may not have been. You want to devote your energies to making this your default state. It crystallizes your intention. There aren't 10 things you have to work on in yourself, just one to cultivate. The phrase "out of your power" also reminds you that you've disconnected from a source of this power within you and outside of you. It's a state you get into. It's not you. This will help you have less self-judgment if your prior approaches haven't worked or if you still react despite your best intentions not to. In this chapter, you will learn what puts you into an out-of-your-power state and keeps you there, and what it takes to get back in your power. As it turns out, I was invited again to present at the White House about 15 years later and said yes. As you start to act in your power, you magnetize opportunities to you. To become more conscious and in command of being in your power, let's first understand its three essential attributes. 1. A sense of agency. You see yourself as the creator of your life. You think, "I can." Life is not happening to you. You maximize what you can control. You always see options, and you are intentional in your choice of responses. You see yourself as responsible for your thoughts, feelings, and actions. You make choices about whether your current situation is right for you, appreciating that you always have a choice. You operate in your stride without limits or interference. 2. A sense of sovereignty. You own who you are. You think, I am. You have an inviolable sense of yourself. You write the narrative about yourself and rewrite narratives that have been put on you. You consciously decide what you believe about yourself. You determine whether you are worthy and enough. You are sure of your values, what you stand for, and what you are here for. Though you learn from others, you trust your own counsel rather than outsourcing your opinion of yourself to others or second guess. What you think, feel, and say all align and inform how you act. You are able to say yes when you genuinely mean it and say no when you don't. You are able to ask for what you want and speak your truth without fear of reprisal. You're driven by your values, not what other people impose on you or how you're trying to get other people to think of you. You know how to create the mental and emotional weather inside of you and surrounding you. You recover quickly back into your center if you react emotionally. You know inner peace. You know what you want and enjoy the choices you make for yourself. You know how to fill your own needs so you don't have to pressure anyone else or make them wrong for not giving you what you need. When others do support and love you, you can take it in and be filled up by it. 3. A sense of efficacy. Your efforts affect change. You think, I make an impact. Your actions have the desired results. You can act to make your situation better, not only for yourself, but for everyone involved. The way you communicate lands. You turn a no into a yes. You move others to action. You can look beyond the finite problem to see infinite possible solutions. You understand all angles in the context, taking into consideration yours and others' needs, and pursue win-win solutions. You resolve the underlying problem at root cause. You attach your own goals to the betterment of all. You know how to get out of bad situations and find or create good new ones. Your approach transcends the current paradigm. In sum, these three attributes of being in your power characterize being in and staying in your flow. These descriptions hint at the vast array of possible things you can control, ways you can manage yourself and find resolution no matter the challenges you are facing. What happens when you are kicked out of your power? Getting kicked out of your power starts when something happens to emotionally hijack you. Each person experiences this in their own way, ranging from an intense internal alarm to a subtle sensation. Maybe you get a pit in your stomach or constriction in your chest or throat. It might be like a streak of electricity coursing through your veins or, conversely, energy draining out of you like rain down the side of a window. Perhaps you want to do a silent scream, or maybe you simply notice a blip on your emotional EKG. After our initial emotional response, our thoughts put us into a mental swirl. Your reaction beelines to your worst insecurities, immediately thinking that others' actions mean you are not enough or you don't matter. Our minds become noisy as we blame the offending person for what they did wrong and think what they should have done instead. We carry the experience with us into our next meeting, into our family life, and into restless nights. We feel as if the other person or people have all the power to determine how the situation unfolds, and we feel made small. Then we act. In the heat of the moment, we might react in a defensive tone. We might avoid, such as not sending an email we know we should send. We numb ourselves with food, drink, drugs, or online entertainment binges. We go on the offensive, strategizing how to get one up on the offender by putting them one down. We might vent endlessly to anyone who will listen, or we might appear as the swan on a lake, displaying calm above the water while full of commotion below the surface. This describes an acute reaction to an interaction you may have on any given day. But when you have to interact with that person or system over time, your response becomes an automatic patterned approach to that important relationship or your life in general. And a natural adaptation can be to dull our emotions to spare ourselves the pain. You might even hold yourself hostage with self-doubt when alone with your thoughts, even despite objective evidence you are crushing it. Once this spiraling occurs, you start to develop the sense that the frustrating situation is just the way things are, or turn the accusatory lens on yourself. This is just the way I am. You might be quite in your power in some, but not other areas of your life. You may know in your mind you are really good at what you do, but in your bones, you still question yourself. You may have a group of supportive friends and a family who loves you, but can't get your manager to see you. You may be a successful entrepreneur, but your children or your partner make you feel disrespected. It confounds you. We all have the resources within us to make agency, sovereignty, and efficacy our default state, so that even when we are pulled out of our power for a time, we can quickly get back in our power. But we also all have response patterns built into our human nature that will put us out of our power and keep us there if we are not intentional. Three power derailers. Overcome your hardwiring to be in your power. Human nature sets us up to be kicked out of our power and stay there when a situation, 1, seems out of your control, 2, activates an unresolved pattern in you, and 3, is not improved by your attempts to make it better. We are even hardwired through evolution to have these derailments determine our responses. But once we are aware of them, we can override them. First, let's start with an understanding of how these three derailers operate. We focus on what we can't control. We only get out of our power when the problem seems out of our control. When you focus on what you can't control, you leak your power. Your nervous system's resources are redirected toward monitoring incoming information about any potential threats to physical survival or emotional well-being. These threat detection parts of your brain are like a Marine sentry on the lookout 24/7, 365. When a threat is perceived, the Marine sentry sounds an alarm to begin problem solving to cope with it. Our minds are programmed to focus much more on what we can't control in a threatening situation than what we can. Your attention will naturally be pulled to the ways you feel done to, assessing the list of factors out of your control. We have a built-in follow-up response which allows us to get back into a place of safety within, once we learn that the stimuli in the environment are no longer a threat. But when we focus too intently on what we can't control, our attention loops only on the threat. Then the Marine sentry can't signal it's okay to let our guard down. Our acute sensitivity to such threats was demonstrated by a study done with college students. They were asked to write about interpersonal situations in which they had power over others, then ones in which others had power over them, and then complete a cognitive task. Even a brief experience of being out of one's power, simply by writing about a situation in which they felt powerless for a few minutes, reduced their sense of agency and what they thought they could control. When threatened, the brain also filters all incoming information through one question: how will this affect me? The survival mechanism of your brain literally sets you up to take things personally. While in early human evolution, the threats we had to be alert to were primarily about our physical safety, David Rock, author of Your Brain at Work, highlights that today threats to our status, certainty, autonomy, relatedness, and fairness, SCARF, are primary. We are wired to be social, and we are constantly looking to other people in order to access how safe we are and how well we are doing. We micro-track and then interpret other people's behavior. This is especially true if you're in a lower power position. You'll pay greater systematic attention to behavior of the person in the higher power position. Over time, your brain associates this, "How will this affect me?" question with the more general question, "What does this mean about me?" This leads us to the second factor that derails us from being in our power, a personal subconscious reaction you have to the perceived threat. We act out of an unresolved pattern. When you become stuck out of power, it's because there is a personal hook that gives the situation a disproportionate effect on you. Your brain associates the current situation with a prior experience that registered strongly with you emotionally, and you perceive the theme as related or being reenacted in the current situation. Every human has had some, or far too many, experiences that have caused us to feel powerless. In order to try to control and make sense of it, we try to explain and assign a meaning to it, which will remain as an unresolved source of fear, pain, or self-doubt unless actively processed. This is like kindling inside of our psyches. Other people's actions or the circumstances we're in can act like a match that lights it afire. These are triggers, a painful reminder of similarly themed past experiences. They teleport us into a real experience of powerlessness. Our kindling leads us to personalize the situation, making it about issues from our past, rather than seeing it objectively in the present. This subconscious process elevates the perceived gravity of the current situation as implying something about who you are beyond the current specifics. We're often unaware of our kindling because it is embedded deeply in our psyche. For example, let's say a colleague left you off an email chain for a meeting. If you are in your power, you might approach the colleague to discuss the value you could bring to the meeting or why it would be helpful for you to hear what the attendees discuss and then ask to be included. But if an unresolved pattern gets triggered, you might instead ruminate about how you've been left out, telling yourself, "I'm not respected. I'm not smart enough to be invited to the table," or "They're trying to marginalize me," fully convinced that that's what's objectively transpired. Even though the specifics of the current scenario might differ markedly from the situations you faced earlier in your life, your mind has connected the current and the past events through a chain of associations. Suddenly, a situation has become a referendum on your worth instead of an everyday interaction among flawed humans. Then here's the clincher. When our kindling has been alighted and we're stuck out of our power, we often look to involve other people in shoring ourselves up. We'll seek their validation and acknowledgement, try to prove ourselves even more, or vent to seek sympathy. We'll hold back to prevent them from criticizing or rejecting us and wait for their permission to boldly do what we know we should. We'll try to please and be perfect in order to not disappoint them. You give away your power trying to change people and circumstances outside of you in order to fix something that is insecure inside of you. As I introduced in my first book, Success Under Stress, the diagram in the PDF that accompanies this audiobook shows you the visual of how we commonly give our power away. You'll act toward other people, depicted as the arrow up the left-hand side of the triangle, in order to get other people to act toward you, depicted as the arrow down the right-hand side of the triangle, so that you can feel secure in yourself. Your time, energy, and attention go toward managing other people's perceptions of you. You outsource your evaluation of yourself to others and overweight their opinions. In short, you involve other people in your own efforts to feel worthy inside. I call these approaches indirect. With an indirect approach, it matters how others think and act toward you because you need their input in order to be in your power inside yourself. By setting up a formula where you have to go through others in order to get the thing you need most inside of you, this gives away your power. It sets you up to be the thermometer. I was the thermometer when I held myself back from an opportunity to make an impact on millions of people's lives because I was worried about what the people around the White House table would think of me. Indirect behaviors are completely normal. As infants, we are biologically hardwired to seek caring responsiveness from important people in our life. It's the way human babies learn to calm their own nervous system and internalize whether we are worthy of being cared for. Just as we need to breathe in oxygen to grow physically, we must take in emotional oxygen from caregivers in order to grow our self-esteem. As a child grows up, we come to see and know ourselves through the eyes of important others, our parents' love and attention, teachers' evaluation and praise, and peers' approval and appreciation are the mechanisms by which we come to know ourselves, favorably or not. Similarly, we are hardwired to avoid physical or emotional harm and be afraid of getting kicked out of the tribe. In short, important people in our early lives serve as a secure base. And when we have a responsive caregiver, we go to them in order to be safe, soothed, and assured we matter. From this home base, we get the fill-up we need to go conquer the world. Indirect behaviors start off as adaptive because we have learned to know ourselves through others' eyes and regulate ourselves through others' input. Many of us continue this approach to feeling secure in ourselves in adulthood. What I discovered in my research at Harvard Medical School is what you have been doing right to try to build your sense of power within, in other words, through other people, is the very approach keeping you out of your power now. If you haven't built the ability to be in your power from your own means, you may keep going to other people to try to get into that state in yourself. And if you don't get the response you need from them, then you're going to try harder to get it from them. It becomes a vicious cycle. You put yourself out of your power and then blame the other person for not being a good source of helping you be in your power. You can learn to stop yourself from making any specific disempowering situation into a general conclusion that you are not enough or unworthy. The fix is to go direct, which means you source your worthiness from within, independent of others' evaluations of you. You feel filled by a sense of reward and satisfaction from your contributions. You source your sense of purpose from your source, however you define it. You become a secure base for yourself to always come home to. Then you have the fill-up you need, as Joe said, to go out and be the one who raises others. If you were thinking of this concept in terms of love, indirect behaviors are like trying to get love. Go direct is be love. Go direct is feel lovable, because that you can control. Then it doesn't matter how limited anyone in your personal life or work family is. To do this, you need to discover what your kindling is and learn to go direct, as I will guide you to do in subsequent chapters. Note, there are four specific types of indirect behaviors, and generic advice can be counterproductive for certain types. Go to www.inyourpowerbook.com to take the full power profile assessment for personalized learning. My client Susan was able to quickly get back in her power this way after years of being stuck in an out-of-power quagmire. A leader in the long-term disability division of an insurance company, she always had more claims to process than she could get through. Despite backlog being due to the company's bureaucratic processes and challenges in hiring adequate staff, and notwithstanding high praise on her performance reviews, she saw the problem as having to do with her not being enough. She was constantly thinking that she wasn't doing enough and the fire drills were hers to fix. She was constantly monitoring whether she was proving to her boss and colleagues that she was doing enough. In one exercise together, she had an aha insight. Her mother had been big into volunteering and helping out at food kitchens. Susan had resented all the time her mother spent doing that work, so she avoided doing any such volunteer work. She felt guilty she was not doing enough, not processing enough claims, not giving enough in her community life. Once she made this connection, she was able to break the hold that kindling had over her and have a new experience of herself as enough, without having to burn herself out taking on more than was humanly possible in the hopes she'd be acknowledged for it. Often the situation throwing us out of our power does, in itself, present real threats to our goals for ourselves and to our well-being. Getting back in our power, then, requires strategic problem-solving that addresses the true issues with effectiveness. This third derailer explains how our brains can work against us taking those approaches. We take flawed approaches to trying to fix the problem. Our natural emotional stress response can derail our effective problem solving, so we overlook the unused power we already have. When out of our power in an emotional state, you can only see a narrow range of options, which may be the same lack of options already thought of, and usually pertain only to how the other person should change. The increased levels of stress hormones in the brain constrict our ability for pattern recognition by shrinking the database searched by the brain. Our brains interpret new information in a way that is consistent with the way you recently interpreted this or another situation. So an out-of-your-power cycle can keep you looping on the same understanding of limited options. Research on the brains of people in high-power and low-power positions revealed that while the goal-oriented centers of a high-power person's brain are active, there is little active goal-seeking among the low-power subjects. I often hear from clients, "Well, I said something, but," with the net that they didn't get a cooperative response or even one at all. This was the case for one of my clients, Tara, who was able to turn her situation around after our first session. She was in sales at a Fortune 100 company. She told me she was ready to leave because her manager of 6 years had systematically denied every request for more resources and better assignments, reserving those for the younger men in the group. It was affecting her income, and she was to the point she had what she termed a victim mentality. We agreed that she would give her best shot at influencing her manager, and if that didn't work, we'd pivot to Plan B and seek a new job for her to move into. She had described the manager as being narcissistic and only managing up, which to her meant never being supported because it was all about him. But knowing this about him gave me a great clue about how she might be able to influence him. We carefully scripted her ask, which instead of being about what she wanted, would allow him to see how her requests would help him to look good for having granted them. The next week, she emailed to say she met with him and got everything she asked for and more. Not only did she stay with the company, but in the subsequent 4 months, she brought in the biggest deal of her career, was promoted, and pocketed an extra $100,000 in commission. In the position she was promoted to, she was able to improve the process by which deals got assigned and resources were accessed by the sales team.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.